Let me ask you a question. When you watch this scene, what do you see? Do you notice the face of the girl, the colors of the cemetery, maybe the clothing she's wearing or her position on and the way she moves through the frame? These are all critical elements of film, don't get me wrong, but they're superficial ones nonetheless. The truth is, many modern day directors have become complacent with their intentions. They build only what can be seen on the surface level, what the audience can just observe and not be challenged by. I think Wes Anderson, for better or worse, has an explicit understanding of how to use his medium to avoid this pitfall. Sure, this can be observed by his obsession with symmetry and vibrant colors, but to me at least, it's exhibited almost perfectly by every frame of the Grand Budapest Hotel. Within the first 5 minutes of the film, Anderson makes it clear that this is not your average story. Instead, it's a story within a story within a story within a story. A writer recounting his interpretation of an experience in a man's life that occurred long ago. Before the first character is even introduced, we can already infer that things are going to take on a somewhat dreamlike quality. They're going to be lucid and exaggerated, as they often are in stories. And the film does not disappoint.
Well, it begins, as it must, with our mutual friend's predecessor, the beloved original concierge of the Grand Budapest. It begins, of course, with...
There are two things I want to say about this scene. First, this tracking shot gives us a really good extended view of a room within the Grand Budapest Hotel. It's exactly as we expected, exaggerated, embellished, and royal. This tonal shift from the modern-day hotel we saw only moments earlier further immerses the viewer within the dreamlike world of this non-existent Eastern European country. Second, pay close attention to this shot. Monsieur Gustave, the concierge of the Grand Budapest and the main character of the movie, dominates the center symmetry, a trope common with important characters in Anderson's films. It's an intimidating shot, and Anderson lingers on it, but it didn't need to be included. The sequence could have just begun here. But this is so much more impactful, and it sets up a visual cue that will continue to communicate the dynamic between Gustav and the lobby boy Zero. More specifically, as the circumstances and the story beats of the film begin to form their friendship, their relationship to the frame will change at the same rate. In early parts of the movie, when Zero first gets his job as a lobby boy at the Grand Budapest, Gustav consistently dominates the frame. He's always front and center, and the camera levels at his eyeline, establishing him as the most important feature of that scene. This is a technique that Anderson will continue to manipulate as Gustav and Zero's friendship begins. He manipulates their positions within the frame to represent the mindset of Gustav. In the beginning, Zero is just another insignificant passerby, someone in the background who can't provide Gustav with money or luxury and therefore is not worthy of his attention. Instead, Gustav pivots his focus on the rich and vain guests who have become so well acquainted with him. In fact, it's hinted that Gustav doesn't really care about them either. They're just simply sources of wealth and luxury, and he has no respect for their real sentimental wishes. Anderson spends these first minutes of the film very intentionally. He defines Gustav's lack of compassion and understanding with one brilliant motif, which just means a distinctive feature or trait. In these early scenes, the motif is this. Gustav is always above and in front of every other character on screen, as well as being significantly louder than every other character too. This one exception being the rich and powerful guests that he panders to, presumably just to milk more money out of them. This motif, like many, is dynamic. It changes, and the first evidence of this change occurs, presumably a couple months after Zero has begun working in the hotel. By this point, Zero and Gustav have become well acquainted, and even if Gustav does not regard Zero as much more than a lobby boy, he respects him for his hard work. The scene in question takes place on a train. Gustav and Zero are going to collect money for Gustav by one of the hotel's rich guests. And as the country is in a militarized state, the train is boarded by a squadron of soldiers, who demand to see the pair's identification papers. Zero, being an immigrant, can only provide a work visa, which is apparently not satisfactory.
That's a migratory visa with stage 3 worker status, France, darling. He's with me.
Come outside, please.
Now, wait a minute. Sit down, Zero. His papers are in order. I cross-referenced them myself with the Bureau of Labor and Servitude. You can't arrest him simply because he's a bloody immigrant. He hasn't done anything wrong. Stop it!
At this moment, a pivotal shift in the dynamic between Gustav and Zero occurs, wherein stress and pressure cause an emotional outburst from Gustav that causes a near instant bond to form between the two.
Take your hands off my lobby boy!
Remember the motif I talked about earlier? Well, this scene is also the first scene where Gustav and Zero are shown equally in the frame. In Gustav's mind, Zero is slowly becoming more and more important in his life, and the film reflects that visually. This is only further encouraged a few scenes later, when Zero and Gustav steal Boy with Apple, a painting that rightfully belongs to Gustav, but has been effectively taken away by the main antagonist. This is the catalyst for the real action of the film. This is where the real adventure begins. And again, Zero and Gustav are represented equally in the frame, only this time it's even more apparent. This visual connection to Gustav's character arc is brilliant, in my opinion. It communicates so much with so little, playing on the subconscious to be noticed only partially by the audience. But critics of Anderson's will point out this type of camera work as a failure, labeling it as pretentious and condescending. I will admit, it does give away a lot of information and could be interpreted as labeling the viewer as unintelligent, incapable of really understanding Gustav and Zero's relationship without help from the director. To me, this is far from the truth, and it appears that Anderson is not only aware of but makes fun of this criticism. He uses a zoom vignette on multiple occasions to introduce drama through comedy. It's cheesy, but intentionally so. He's making fun of his critics by doing exactly what they criticize him for. I bring this up because it's another really good example of motif. Granted, it is considerably different than Gustav's motif and the way he occupies the frame, but I still think it proves that Anderson has a really good understanding of how to use the frame and the medium of film to further communicate his ideas and the story beats of the movie. As the film progresses, and so does Zero and Gustav's friendship, their equality within the frame becomes more and more apparent. Anderson goes so far as to consistently show them sitting down, side by side. Now even their height difference is removed. In fact, for the last half of the film, Zero will even take a turn at the center of the frame, signifying that he's become such an important part of Gustav's story that Gustav is actually okay with him being more important than he is. The Grand Budapest Hotel is a poetic movie. Sure, the character arcs are relatively predictable, and the movie's story beats follow an easily understandable path, but the motif and repetition of Anderson's directing makes the story immensely enjoyable despite that. It's a breath of fresh air, a complete reimagining of a typical coming-of-age story. In the final scene of the movie, Zero and Gustav are presented equally within the frame. Their friendship and equality in Gustav's mind is long-standing, so this equal presence is to be expected. But strangely, Agatha, Zero's fiancée, is also equal in the frame. Unlike Zero, Gustav has not spent a lot of time with, nor had his life saved by Agatha, and yet she's still relatively equal in his mind. She has significance to his and Zero's story, and he accepts that with open arms. This represents the final portion of Gustav's character arc. He's learned to lean into friendship rather than to hide from it, and as a result, he's no longer so lonely. Sure, Monsieur Gustav of the Grand Budapest Hotel is still vain and insecure, and he still craves riches and fame, but he's learned a lesson so incredibly valuable that the viewer is willing to look past that and be charmed by who he really is. It's a realization that lingers, asking to be made for each and every one of us, and it makes his death only a few moments later all the more melancholy, but in the same way, acceptable. Gustav was saved, just in time, from falling into the void of vanity and insecurity forever. His transformation is complete, and for that, we are thankful. Thanks for watching.